Old Filth by Jane Gardam, read by Bill Wallis. Part 1. Scene: Inner Temple. The Benchers' luncheon room of the Inner Temple. Light pours through the long windows upon polished table, silver, glass. A number of judges and benchers finishing lunch. One chair has recently been vacated and the benchers are looking at it. The Queen's Remembrancer. I suppose we all know who that was. Junior Judge. I've no idea. Senior Judge.
It seemed to be a famous face.
The Common Sergeant.
It was Old Filth.
JJ.
What?
But he must have died years ago. Contemporary of F.E. Smith. C.S.
No, it was Old Filth. Great advocate, judge, and bit of a wit, said to have invented F.I.L.T.H.
Failed in London, try Hong Kong. He tried Hong Kong. Modest, nice chap. S.J.
Hard worker. Well, the pollution law, feathers on pollution.
C.S.
Filth on filth.
S.J.
An old joke. He must be 100.
C.S.
Nowhere near. He's not been retired all that long. Looks a great age, though.
Q.R.
Transparent. You could see the light through him.
C.S. Magnificent looks, though. And still sharp. Q.R.
He's up here doing things to his will. He's got Betty with him. She's still alive, too. They've had a soft life. Far Eastern bar. And made a packet. Looked after themselves.
C.S.
Never put a foot wrong, Old Filth. Very popular.
Q.R.
Except with Veneering.
S.J.
Yes, that was odd. Out of character.
Q.R.
For such a benevolent old bugger. Do you think there are mysteries?
S.J.
Old Filth mysterious.
Q.R.
It's a wonder he's not just a bore.
C.S.
Yes, but he's not.
Child of the Raj, public school, Oxford, the bar. But he's not a bore. Women went mad for him.
Q.R.
Coffee? Are you going through?
C.S.
Yes, 10 minutes. My clerk's packing in the next case. He'll be ranting at me, tapping his watch.
Q.R.
Yes, this isn't Hong Kong. Coffee? But it was good to see the old coelacanth.
C.S.
Yes. Yes, indeed it was. Tell our grandchildren.
The Donheads. He was spectacularly clean. You might say ostentatiously clean. His ancient fingernails were rimmed with purest white. The few still gold hairs below his knuckles looked always freshly shampooed, as did his curly, still bronze hair. His shoes shone like conkers. His clothes were always freshly pressed. He had the elegance of the 1920s, for his garments, whatever they looked like off, always became him. Always a Victorian silk handkerchief in the breast pocket. Always yellow cotton or silk socks from Harrods, and some still perfect from his old days in the East. His skin was clear and, in a poor light, young. His colleagues at the bar called him Filth, but not out of irony. It was because he was considered to be the source of the old joke, "Failed in London, try Hong Kong." It was said that he had fled the London bar very young, very poor, on a sudden whim just after the war, and had done magnificently well in Hong Kong from the start. Being a modest man, they said, he had called himself a parvenu, a fraud, a carefree spirit. Filth, in fact, was no great maker of jokes, was not at all modest about his work, and seldom, except in great extremity, went in for whims. He was loved, however, admired, laughed at, kindly, and still much discussed many years after retirement. Now, nearing 80, he lived alone in Dorset.
His wife, Betty, was dead, but he often prattled on to her around the house. Astonishingly, in one so old, his curly hair was not yet grey. His eyes and mind alert, he was a delightful man. He had always been thought so. A man whose distinguished life had run steadily and happily. There was no smell of old age about his house. He was rich and took for granted that it and he would be kept clean, fed and laundered by servants as it had always been. He knew how to treat servants and they stayed for years. Betty had been successful with servants too. Both she and Old Filth had been born in what Americans called the Orient and the British Raj had called the Far East. They knew who they were, but they were unself-conscious and popular. After Betty's death, the self-mockery dwindled in Old Filth. His life exploded. He became more ponderous. He began, at first slowly, to flick open shutters on the past that he had, as a sensible man with sensible and learned friends, he was a QC and had been a judge, kept clamped down. His success as an advocate in Hong Kong had been phenomenal, for he had had ease, grasp, diligence and flair. His career had taken off the minute he had begun to be briefed by the Straits Chinese. It was not just that scraps of Eastern languages began to re-emerge from his childhood in Malaya, but a feeling of nearness to the Oriental mind. When Old Filth spoke Malay, or less ably, Mandarin, you heard an unsuspected voice. Chinese, Malay and Bengali lawyers, though often trained at Oxford and the Inns of Court, were thought to be not straightforward, but Filth, now Old Filth, and after his retirement, often dear Old Filth, had found them perfectly straightforward and to his taste. All his life he kept a regard for Chinese values. The courtesy, the sudden thrust, the holiness of hospitality, the pleasure in money, the decorum, the importance of food, the discretion, the cleverness. He had married a Scotswoman, but she had been born in Peking. She was dumpy and tweedy, with broad Lanarkshire shoulders and square hands, but she spoke Mandarin perfectly and was much more at home with Chinese ways and idiom than she ever felt on her very rare visits to Scotland. Her passion for jewellery was Chinese, and her strong Scottish fingers rattled the trays of jade in the street markets of Kowloon, stirring the stones like pebbles on a beach. "When you do that," Old Filth would say, when they were young and he was still aware of her all the time, "your eyes are almond-shaped." "Poor old Betty," he would say to her ghost across in another armchair in the house in Dorset, to which they had retired and in which he had died. And why ever Dorset? Nobody knew. Some family tradition somewhere, perhaps. Phil said it was because he disliked everywhere else in England, Betty because she felt the cold in Scotland. They both had a dismissive attitude towards Wales. But if any old pair had been born to become retired expats in Hong Kong, members of the cricket club, the jockey club, stalwarts of the English Lending Library, props of St. Andrew's Church and St. John's Cathedral, they were Filth and Betty. People who would always be able to keep servants. Filth was very rich. Who would live in a house on the peak, be forever welcoming hosts to every friend of a friend's friend visiting the colony. When you thought of Betty, you saw her at her round rosewood dining table, looking quickly about her to see if plates were empty, tinkling her little bell to summon the snaky, smiling girls in their household livery of identical Chong Sams. Old Filth and Betty were perfectly international people, beloved ornaments at every one of the memorial services to old friends, English or Chinese, in the cathedral. In the last years, these deaths had been falling thick and fast upon them. Was it, perhaps, the pound that drew them to Dorset? The thought of having to survive one day in Hong Kong on a pension? But the part of Dorset they had chosen was far from cheap. Betty was known to have her own money, and Filth had always said merrily that he had put off making judge for as long as possible so that he hadn't to live on a salary. And they had no children, no responsibilities, no one to come back to England for. Or was it, the most likely thing, the end of empire?
the drawing near of 1997. Was it the unbearableness of the thought of the arrival of the barbarians? The now unknown but certainly changed mainland Chinese whose grandparents had fed the baby Miss Betty on soft, cloudy jellies and told her frightening fairy tales. Neither Filth nor Betty cared for the unknown, and already 5 years before they left, English was not being heard so much in Hong Kong shops and hotels, and when it was heard, it was being spoken less well. Many familiar English and Chinese had disappeared to London or Seattle or Toronto, and many children had vanished to foreign boarding schools. The finest of the big houses on the peak were in darkness behind steel grills, and at Betty's favourite jeweller, the little girls behind the counter, who sat all day threading beads and who still seemed to look under 16, although she had known them 20 years, glanced up more slowly now when she rang the bell on the armour-plated door. They kept their fixed smiles, but somehow found fewer good stones for her. Chinese women, she knew, had not the same difficulty. So suddenly Filth and Betty were gone, gone forever, from the sky-high curtains of glittering lights, unflickering gold, soft green and rose, from the busy waters of the finest harbour in the world, and the perpetual drama of every sort of boat, the junks and oil tankers and the private yachts like swans, and the comforting bottle-green bulk of the little star ferries that chugged back and forth to Kowloon all day and most of the night. "This deck accommodates 319 passengers." Filth had loved the certainty of the 19. So they were gone, far from friends and over 70, to a house deep in the Donheads on the Dorset-Wiltshire border. An old, low stone house that could not be seen from its gate. A rough, narrow drive climbed up to it, curving towards it and out of sight. The house sat on a small plateau, looking down over forests of every sort and colour of English tree. And far across the horizon was a long, scalpel line of milky, chalky downland, dappled with shadows drawn across it by the clouds. No place in the world is less like Hong Kong or the Far East. Yet it was not so remote that a doctor might start suggesting in a few years' time that it might be kinder to the social services if they were to move nearer to civilization. There was a village half a mile up the hilly road that passed their gate, and half a mile in the other direction, also up a hill, for their drive ran down into a dip, where a church and a shop. There were other houses among the trees. There was even a house next door, its gateway alongside theirs, its drive curving upwards as did their own, though branching away. It disappeared as did their own. So they were secluded, but not cut off. And it worked. They made it work. Betty was the sort of woman who had plotted that the end of her life would work, and Filth, having Betty, had no fears of failure. They changed, of course. They discarded much. They went out and about very little. Betty wrote a great many letters. They put their hearts into becoming content, safe in their successful lives. Filth had always said, of his cases, "I am trained to forget. Otherwise," he said, "how could I function?" Facts, memories, the pain of life, of lives in chaos, have to be forgotten. Filth had condemned men to death, had seen innocent men convicted. As a silk, he reckoned that 50% of his cases had gone wrong. In Hong Kong, the judges lived in an enclave of palaces, but behind steel gates guarded night and day. In the Donheads, they felt safe behind the lock of their old-fashioned farmhouse door that could never accidentally be left on the latch. Betty gardened. Filth read thrillers and biographies, worked now and then in his tool shed. He kept his judge's wig in its oval black and gold tin box on the hearth, like a grey cat in a basket. Then, in time, as there was nobody but Betty to be amused, he moved it to his wardrobe to lie with his black silk stockings and buckled shoes. He had not brought the black cap home. Betty sat sewing. She often stared for hours at the trees. They went to the supermarket in Shaftesbury once a week in their modest car. A gardener came to do the heavy digging, and a woman from a nearby village came in four times a week to clean, cook, and do the laundry. Betty said that Hong Kong's legacy was to make foreigners unable to do their own washing. After Betty died, the gardener and the woman continued to work for Filth. Filth's lifetime of disciplined charm survived well. Or so it seemed. Looking back, Filth knew that beneath his apparent serenity, the years after Betty's departure had been a time of mental breakdown, and that mental breakdown in someone conditioned to an actor's life, which is the bar, can be invisible both to the sufferer and everyone else. And this, the event he came to see as the beginning of enlightenment, occurred one Christmas, 2 years on. The cleaning lady started it. Letting herself in with her door key, talking as usual before she was over the threshold.
"Well," she said, "what about this then, Sir Edward? You never hear a thing down this way till it's happened. Next door must have moved. Your next door. There's removal vans all up and down the drive and loads of new stuff being carried in. They say it's another lawyer from Singapore, like you."
"Hong Kong," corrected Filth, as he always did.
"Hong Kong, then. They'll be wanting a domestic, I dare say, but they're out of luck. I'm well suited here, you're not to worry. I'll find them someone if they ask. I've enough to do."
A few days later, Filth was told, courtesy of the village shop, the new neighbour's name. It was, as the cleaning lady had said, indeed that of another Hong Kong lawyer, and it was the name of the only man in his professional life, or come to that, his private life, that old Filth had ever detested. The extraordinary effect this man had had upon him over many years, and it had been much remarked upon, and the usually buttoned-up Filth had not cared, was like venom sprayed from the mouths of Chinese dragons. The same had gone for Terry Veneering's opinion of old Filth. Betty had never spoken of it, kept herself apart, became silent, remote. Filth's clerk, other lawyers, found the enmity almost a chemical, physical thing. In Hong Kong, the bar watched. Old Filth, delightful, wise old Filth and swashbuckling Veneering, did not have words in court. They spat poisons. They did not cross swords. They set about each other with scimitars. Old Filth believed that Terry Veneering was all that was wrong with the British masters of this divine colony. Jumped up, arrogant, blustering, loud, cynical and common, and far too good at games. Without such as Veneering, who knows? Veneering treated the Chinese as if they were invisible, flung himself into pompous rites of empire, strutted at ceremonies in his black and gold, cringed with sycophancy before the governor, drank too much. In court he treated his opponent to personal abuse. Once, when they were both still counsel, in an interminable case about a housing estate built over a Chinese graveyard, the housing estate mysteriously refused to prosper, Veneering spent days sneering at primitive beliefs, or so old Filth said in and out of court. What Veneering said about old Filth he never inquired, but there was a mutual seething dislike. Betty became haggard with the subject. "For Veneering got away with everything," snarled Filth. "He bestrode the colony on his thick legs like a colossus, booming on at parties about his own excellence. During a state visit by royalty, he boasted about his boy at Eton. Later it was all my boy at Cambridge, then my boy in the Guards. Insufferable," cried Filth. Betty said, "Oh, hush, hush." Filth's first thought now was, "Well, thank God Betty's gone." His second thought was that he would have to move. However, the next-door house was as invisible as Filth's, its garden secret behind the long band of firs that curved between their joint drives. These trees grew broader, taller all the time, and even when the leaves of other trees fell and it became winter,
there was neither sight nor sound of the new neighbour.
"He's a widower, living alone," said the cleaning lady. "His wife used to be a Chinese."
Old Filth remembered then that Veneering had married a Chinese woman. Strange to have forgotten. Why did it stir up in him such a mixture of hatred and smugness? Almost of relief. He remembered the wife now. Her downward-looking eyes, the curious chandelier earrings she wore. He remembered her at the racecourse in a bright yellow silk dress, Veneering alongside. Great, coarse, golden fellow, 6'2", his strangled voice trying to sound English public school. Old Filth dozed off then with this picture before him, wondering at the clarity of an image 30 years old when what happened yesterday had receded into darkness. He was nearly 80 now. Veneering was a bit younger. Well, they could each keep their own corner. They need never meet. Nor did they. The year went by, and the next one. A friend from Hong Kong, young chap of 60, called and said, "I believe old Terry Veneering lives somewhere down here, too. Do you ever come across him?" "He's next door." "No, never." "Next door? My dear fellow, I'd have been wise to move away." "But you mean you've never..." "No." "And he's made no gesture?" "Christopher, your memory is short." "Well, I knew, of course, you were both irrational in that direction, but..." Old Filth walked his friend down to the gate. Beside it stood Veneering's gate, overhung by ragged yews. A short length of drainpipe to take a morning newspaper was attached to Veneering's gate. It was identical to the one that had lain by Old Filth's gate for many years.
"He copied my drainpipe," said Old Filth. "He never had an original notion."
"I've half a mind to call," said Christopher.
"Well, you needn't come and see me again if you do," said courteous Old Filth.
Seated in his car in the road, the friend considered the mystery of what convictions survive into dotage, and how wise he had been to stay on in Hong Kong.
"You don't feel like a visit, Eddie?" he asked out of the car window. "Why not come out for Christmas? It's not so much changed that there'll ever be anywhere in the world like it."
But Filth said he never stirred at Christmas. Just a taxi to the White Hart at Salisbury for luncheon. Good place. No paper hats. No streamers.
"I remember Betty with streamers tangled up in her hair and her pearls and gold chains in Hong Kong."
But Filth thanked him and declined and waved him off. On Christmas morning, Filth thought again of Christopher as he was waiting for the taxi to the White Hart, watching from a window whose panes were almost blocked with snow, snow that had been falling when he'd opened his bedroom curtains 5 hours ago at 7 o'clock. Big, fast, determined flakes. They fell and fell. They danced. They mesmerized. After a few moments, you couldn't tell if they were going up or down. Thinking of the road at the end of his drive, the deep hollow there, he wondered if the taxi would make it. At 12:15 he thought he might ring and ask, but waited until 12:30, as it seemed tetchy to fuss. He discovered the telephone was dead.
"Ah,"
he said.
"Ah."
There were mince pies and a ham shank, a good bottle somewhere. He'd be all right. A pity, though. Break with tradition. He stood staring at the Christmas cards. Fewer again this year. As for presents, nothing except one from his cousin Claire. Always the same, 2 handkerchiefs, more than he ever sent her, but she had had the pearls. He must send her some flowers. He picked up one large, glossy card and read, "A Merry Christmas from the Ideal Tailor, Century Arcade, Star Building, Hong Kong, to an old and esteemed client." Every year, never failed. Still had his suits, 20 years old. He wore them sometimes in summer. Snowflakes danced around a Chinese house on stilts, red Chinese characters,
a rosy Father Christmas waving from a corner. Stilts. Houses on stilts. Suddenly he missed Betty. Longed for her. Felt that if he turned round now, quickly, there she would be. But she was not. Outside there was a strange sound, a long, sliding noise and a thump, a heavy thump. It might well be the taxi skidding on the drive and hitting the side of the house. Filth opened the front door but saw nothing but snow. He stepped quickly out upon his doorstep to look down the drive, and behind him the front door swung to, fastening with a solid pre-war click. He was in his bedroom slippers. Otherwise he was dressed in trousers, a singlet, which he always wore, being a gentleman, thank God, shirt and tie, and the thin cashmere cardigan Betty had bought him years ago. Already it was sopped through. Filth walked delicately along the side of the house in his slippers, bent forward, screwing his old eyes against the snow to see if by any chance... But he knew that the back door was locked, and the French windows. He turned off towards the tool shed over the invisible, slippery grass. Locked. He thought of the car in the garage. He hadn't driven now for some time, not since the days of terror. Mrs. Thing did the shopping now. It was scarcely used. But perhaps the garage? The garage was locked. Nothing for it but to get down the drive somehow and wait for the taxi under Veneering's yews. In his tiptoe way he passed the heap of snow that had fallen off the roof and had sounded like a slithering car. "I'm a bloody old fool," he said. From the gate he looked out upon the road. It was a gleaming sheet of snow in both directions. Nothing had disturbed it for many hours. All was silent as death. Filth turned and looked up Veneering's drive. That too was pristine silk, unmarked by birds, unpocked by fallen berries. Snow and snow, falling and falling. Thick, wet, ice cold. His thinning hair, ice cold. Snow had gathered inside his collar, his cardigan, his slippers, all ice cold. His knobbly hands were freezing as he grasped first one yew branch and then the next. Hand over hand, he made his way up Veneering's drive. "He'll be with the sun," thought Old Filth. "That, or there'll be some ghastly house party going on. Golfers, old cobwebs from the temple, smart solicitors, gin." But the house, when it came in view, was dark and seemed empty, abandoned for years. Old Filth rang the bell and stood on the porch. The bell tinkled somewhere far away inside, like Betty's at the rosewood dining table in the mid-levels. And what the hell do I do now? He's probably gone to that oaf, Christopher, and they are carousing in the Peninsula Hotel. It'll be, what, late night now? They'll have reached the brandy and cigars, the cigars presented in a huge, shallow box, the maitre d' bowing like a priest before the sacrament. The vulgarity. Probably kill the pair of them. Hello. A light had been switched on inside the house, and a face peered from behind a curtain in a side window. Then the front door was opened slightly by a bent old man with a strand or two of blonde hair.
Filth? Come in.
Thank you.
No coat?
I just stepped across. I was looking out for my taxi for the White Hart Christmas luncheon. Just hanging about. I thought I'd call and...
Merry Christmas. Good of you.
They stood in the drear, unhollied hall.
I'll get your towel. Better take off your cardigan. I'll find you another. Whiskey?
In the brown and freezing sitting room, a jigsaw puzzle, only 1/8 completed, was laid out over a huge table. Table and jigsaw were both white with dust. The venture looked hopeless.
"Too much damn sky,"
said Veneering as they stood contemplating it.
"I'll put another bar on. I don't often sit in here. You must be cold. Maybe we'll hear your car from here, but I doubt it. I'd guess it won't get through.
I wonder if I might use your phone. Mine seemed to be defunct.
Mine too, I'd guess, if yours is, said Veneering. By all means, try.
The phone was dead. They sat before two small red wireworms stretched across the front of an electric fire. Some sort of antique, thought Filth. Haven't seen one like that in 60 years. Chambers in the years of the Great Fog. In a display case on the chimney-piece, he saw a pair of exotic chandelier earrings. The fire, the earrings, the whiskey, the jigsaw, the silence, the eerily falling snow, made him all at once want to weep.
I was sorry to hear about Betty, said Veneering.
I was sorry about Elsie, said Filth, remembering her name and her still and beautiful and unhappy Chinese face. Your son?
Dead, said Veneering. Killed. Army.
I am most terribly sorry. So dreadfully sorry. I hadn't heard.
We don't hear much these days, said Veneering.
Maybe we don't want to. We had too many hearings.
Filth watched the arthritic, stooped old figure shamble across the room to the decanter.
Not good for the bones, this climate,
said Veneering, shambling back.
Did you think of staying on?
Good God, no.
It suited you so well. Then Filth said something very odd. Better than us, I always thought. Better than me, anyway. And Betty never talked about it. She was very Scotch, you know.
Plenty of Scots in Hong Kong, said Veneering. You two seemed absolutely welded, melded into the place. Betty and her Chinese jewellery.
Oh, she tried, said Filth sadly. She was very faithful.
Another?
I should be getting home.
It dawned on old Filth that he would have to ask a favour of Veneering. He had already lost a good point to him by calling round, wet to the skin. Veneering was still no fool. He'd spotted the telephone business. It would be difficult to regain his position. Maybe make something out of being the first to break the silence. Maturity, magnanimity, water under the bridge, Christmas Day, hint at a larger spirit. He wouldn't mention locking himself out. But how was he to get home? Mrs. Thing's key was 3 miles off, and she wasn't coming in again until New Year's Day. He could hardly stay here. Good God! With Veneering.
I've thought of coming to see you, said Veneering. Several times, as a matter of fact, this past year. Getting on, both of us.
Old Filth was silent. He himself had not thought of doing anything of the sort, and could not pretend.
Couldn't think of a good excuse, said Veneering. Bit afraid of the reception. Bloody hot-tempered type I used to be. We weren't exactly similar.
I've forgotten what type I was, said Filth, again surprising himself. Not much of anything, I expect.
Bloody good advocate, said Veneering.
You made a damn good judge, said Filth, remembering that this was true. Better than I was.
Only excuse I could think of was a feeble one, said Veneering. There's a key of yours here hanging in my pantry. Front door. Chub. Your address is on the label. Must have been here for years. The neighbours being neighbourly long ago, I expect. Maybe you have one of mine.
No, said Filth. No, I have not seen one.
Could have let myself in any time, said Veneering. Murdered you in your bed.
There was a flash of the old black mischief.
Must you go? I don't think there's going to be a taxi. It would never make the hill. I'll get that key, unless you want me to hold on to it. For an emergency?
Another hard look.
No,
said Filth with court decorum.
No, I'll take it and see if it works.
On Veneering's porch, wearing Veneering's ghastly overcoat, Filth paused. The snow was easing. He heard himself say,
Boxing Day tomorrow. If you're on your own, I've a ham shank and some decent claret.
Pleasure,
said Veneering. On his own doorstep, Filth thought, Will it turn? It did. The house was beautifully warm, but he made up the fire. The water would be hot, thank God. Get out of these clothes. Hello? What? He thought he heard something in the kitchen. Hello? Yes? He went through and found it empty. The snow had stopped at last, and the windows were squares of black light. He thought, peering forward into the gloaming, Someone is looking in. But he could see no signs of footprints anywhere, and drew the curtains. He peeped into cupboards to make sure of things for tomorrow. Didn't want to look a fool. There was a can of shark's fin soup, tin of crab meat, good rice, package of parmesan, avocado. Fine, fine. Behind him in the hall, he heard something like a chuckle.
Who the hell is that? Hello?
Had the fellow had two keys? Murdered you in your bed.
Edward! Edward! Stop these fantasies! You're too old. You're no longer seven.
A man's voice. Good God, I'm going senile. Yes, sir, he said. Kettle, hot water bottle, bath. I'm old. The phone rang.
You back safely? Asked Veneering's voice. I thought I'd try the phone. We're in touch again.
Oh, thanks, Veneering. 1 o'clock tomorrow?
Yes. Would you like me to bring my chessmen?
Got some. Maybe next time.
Next time.
So it wasn't Veneering, he ruminated in the bath, idly watching his old greying pubic hair floating like fern on the delicious hot water. Steam filled the bathroom. He almost slept. Better get out, somehow, or it'll be all over. He turned his lanky frame so that he was on all fours, facing the porcelain floor of the bath, balanced on his spread hands and his sharp knees, one of them none too excellent, and slithered his feet about to get some sort of purchase near the taps. Slowly, the long length of him arose, feet squeaking a little. He pulled the plug out and watched the soapy water begin to drain, bubbling round his now rosy feet. He thought of another river. Black and brown babies splashing. A girl, all warmth and laughter, his head against her thighs. The water gurgled away. Getting more difficult. Must get a shower. Won't have one of those bloody mats with suction pads, though. Won't have what they call the social services. Veneering doesn't, you can see. Mind, Veneering doesn't look as if he has baths at all. Poor old bugger. Wrapped in a white bath towel, he padded about. Slippers, bathrobe. Perfectly well. Take a little something to bed? No. Eat it over the telly. Anchovy toast. Tea. Enough whiskey. Ah. Blaze up, fire. Mustn't drop off.
Don't drop off, said a woman's voice. Don't drop off the perch. Not yet.
Hey. Hello. What?
Betty?
But again, nobody there. Hope I'm not feverish.
And I'm not being a fool,
he shouted to the door of Betty's old bedroom and shut his own bedroom door behind him. Perfectly in charge. The bed was warm and his own. Extraordinary, really, the idea of sharing a bed. Bourgeois. Something Betty and I never talked about. This is not the time of frenzy, he heard himself say out loud, as the images of the day merged into dreams. He was clinging to someone on a boat deck, and the sea a silver skin. There was screaming, but it was somewhere else and hardly woke him. "We dealt with all that," he said, "in what they call my long, untroubled and uneventful life." "Sleep, Filth," said a voice. "Nobody knew you like I did." Which of them said that? He wondered. Kota Kinakulu.
"Yes, yes, yes,"
said Auntie May of the Baptist Mission, striding up the gangplank.
"Now then, here we are. Excellent."
The motor launch, now and then trying its engine to see whether it would be safe to let it die, stirred the black water around it, rocked and snorted. All across the wide river, small waves slapped and tipped. Heat seemed to drip from the trees like oil. It was summer, the monsoon coming, and when it did, the river traffic would die. This was why they were getting the baby home at only 1 week old. Otherwise, he would have been stranded in the port where he had gone to be born. Here they were, safely home, but it had been a near thing. A 2-day journey, and Auntie May, after she had seen him safely to his father's house, would have to make it back again herself, alone and at once. On the journey out to the port, not much more than a week ago, the baby, not yet born, had travelled the river in a native boat with his mother and the Malay woman who was now climbing the grass ladder to the landing stage, sorrowful and frightened, behind Auntie May. She had carried her own baby, for she was the wet nurse who had been taken to Mrs. Feathers' confinement in case of an emergency should Mrs. Feathers have been unable to feed the child herself. Nobody had expected Mrs. Feathers to die. The clinic at the port was good, the Baptist Mission efficient and known to her already, for she had been a nurse before marriage to Feathers, the district officer of Kota Kinakulu province. She was a tough, lean Scot, like her husband, solid as a rock. She had nursed him through his war wounds of 1914, quieted his shell shock, coped with his damaged ankle, borne his mad rages, loved him. She had been born in the East herself, loved the climate, the river, the people, and had never ailed for a day of this her first and straightforward pregnancy. She had brought to the clinic only the wet nurse and her prayer book, knowing that she would be back within the month. As she left, she had been helped a little into the open boat, but had not looked back. The landing stage stood on its high, crooked stilts, with only one person watching the boat disappear round the bend of the river. A girl of 12 called Ada, the wet nurse's eldest child. As stick-thin as the landing stage itself, the girl wound her arms about the rough branches and stayed long after the boat had disappeared. Comfortable in the long, low boat, Mrs. Feathers in her loose cotton dress, never a sarong, she was the district officer's wife, had scarcely looked pregnant. The baby had dropped low in the womb and become very quiet, which its mother knew meant the birth was imminent. In the long house where they had rested that night, she had not worried that the child might be born early. With the peaceful happiness that often predicts labour, she had smiled and knitted a tiny lace jacket, fondly taking a strand of wool at a time and loosening it, holding it high. She had knitted most of the night, listening to the baboon on the roof clacking like a typewriter in short, unaccountable snatches of baboon monologue. The wet nurse, her own baby beside her, lay on the floor, terrified at being a day's journey downriver from home. She whimpered.
"Now, now," said Mrs. Feathers, patting her. "Hush, don't be afraid. Tomorrow we'll be at the port, and the next day the new baby will be here."
"I know."
"Then soon we shall all go home."
And she held up the jacket and looked at the pattern by the light of the kerosene lamp on the floor. She knew that the baby would be a girl and was finishing off the little garment with pink lacy scallops. She finished the last scallop the following night in the clinic, but gave birth to a long, rangy, red-headed, 8-pound boy. She was delighted with him, Edward, and passed the jacket to the wet nurse's silky brown baby who never wore it. And the next day, puerperal fever began its cruel course, and 3 days later Mrs. Feathers died. 10 days after that, the Welsh missionary Auntie May was plodding firmly on board the river steamer, which might be the last to run before the onset of the monsoon, one big hand on the rail of the gangplank, the other arm tight round the swaddled child. Behind came the weeping and now indispensable wet nurse with her baby. She had wept for 2 days. Auntie May never wept. She had, however, felt a great plunge of spirits as the river boat rounded the bend of the river before the district officer's landing, for there was nobody there except for the same young girl sitting at the ladder's top with her arms tight round her knees. The boat lay in the water, silent, waiting for people to appear. Nobody. Auntie May knew that though there was neither telephone nor mail direct to the district officer's quarters, and their attempt to send a cable had failed, the news of his wife's death would certainly have seeped through to Alistair Feathers. She had half expected him to turn up at the port to bring his son home himself. News flies fast through the jungle. Attendance at his wife's funeral would, of course, have been impossible, for the body had to be buried immediately, then in Kutakinakulu province. "Not here," Auntie May allowed herself to say. The wet nurse was not surprised, however. Mr. Feathers had not come down to the landing stage to see his wife leave. Their goodbye, for them a very affectionate goodbye, a kiss on the cheek, however had this child been conceived, had taken place inside the veranda of the house. A quick embrace, then out and down the veranda steps, Captain Feathers calling to the others to be ready. The wet nurse was being well paid and had been groomed for her possible job of nursing the baby with quantities of good food, and watched over against the betel nut and alcohol. Her elder daughter had come down to the landing stage, helped Mrs. Feathers to the gangplank. Mrs. Feathers had suddenly turned and given the girl a kiss, and watched the boat sidle towards the current and then pass from sight. Here the girl was now, against Captain Feathers's orders, and she had watched for 2 days, her legs pressed against the banana leaf barrier, desperately watching. At the port, these choppy waves had been nowhere to be seen, and the river had run oily and thick, seemed hardly to move. Here, though, upriver, there were no glowworm lights on the great invisible nets, no sounds of fishermen calling from boat to boat, no ghostly cartwheels of weed flying like skaters on the surface of the running river, almost outstripping it. No crocodile snout at the port, no plop or scream of waterbird dropping on prey. Here, on the landing stage, upriver, fat metallic lizards moved about, long jaws angled for grubs in the leaves. They moved silently around her feet. She kicked them away. They were harmless things. And here was the riverboat. Would Mrs. Feathers be there? If she was indeed dead, her strong young body, her bright, happy face, would be already decaying in the wet earth of the port's Christian cemetery. The boat's engine reawakened with a roar, and the boat approached the landing stage. Ada, the brown girl, twisted her arms tighter among the banana leaves. Here came light. Men, not the district officer, appeared to catch ropes. The boat anchored, the engine stopped, the boat rocked and shuddered, and Ada's mother and her baby sister and big Auntie May from the mission began to disembark. Auntie May carried a light bundle. When she had both feet on the rickety platform, Auntie May looked at the girl and asked if she were the wet nurse's big daughter. Ada said yes, and looked at the bundle. And Auntie May put it in her arms. Ada's mother went by, head down over her own baby, afraid of seeing the district officer somewhere in the shadows. But there was no district officer. Alistair Feathers was at his desk working, tonight not even drinking.
When Auntie May was admitted, he shook hands with her and sent for a servant to see her to her room, show her the bathhouse, make sure that food was taken to her. "I can stay for several days," she said. "I'll risk the monsoon, to see that all is as well as can be for him."
For him?
"For your son. He is Edward. He's a fine boy."
"Good. Good."
He did not ask to see the baby, who, by the time Auntie May left a week later, was the amazement of the village. A child with bright blue eyes and white, white skin and curly chestnut hair. After Auntie May had left, with a donation of £10 to the mission, he gave orders for Ada to take charge of the child. Auntie May had already given orders, and the £10, that Ada should sit each evening with the baby on the steps of his father's veranda. This she did for many months, but Alistair Feathers never came near. During the monsoon, Ada and the baby moved up the steps and onto the veranda, and sat there listening to the deluge, the crashing, steaming torrent of the rain. And at last the girl was told by the district officer's servant to go away and take the child to live with her and his wet nurse in their family hut. And so the baby's first years were in the longhouse, among brown skins, brown eyes, scraps of coloured clothes, the Malay language, often sleeping, sometimes making musical singing, dreamily passing the time against the roar of the river and the rain. At night, the lamps swung from the rafters and the baby watched the flames with their halos of moths, heard the baboons with pleasure, saw the silver lizards without fear, their questing, swinging heads, and the geckos hooked into the mesh of the walls, puffing out their lurid throats. He listened to the racket of the rats in the thatch, once watched with rapture as a fat snake came sliding up from a post hole, observed it being killed. He was satisfied by the nourishment of the wet nurse, but passionate in his love for the girl. Soon he stretched to pat her face, suck her chin, her ear. One day, at 2 months, gazing at her, he gave a crow of laughter like a boy of two. Because of the memory of the child's kind mother, the longhouse respected him and accepted him, an ivory child in their warm dun dust. And he was passed about, rocked to sleep, talked to and sung to, and understood only Malay. By the time he was one, he rolled and tottered and waddled in the village compound with the other children. There were a number of pale-skinned, half-caste children from the Raj's peccadilloes. Sometimes this child's father crossed the compound, but seemed not to see him, not to notice his wife's chestnut curls. The village observed the district officer. Captain Feathers was a strong, just governor, but nobody liked him. His child was given extra attention, and from Ada, intense, unswerving, obsessive adoration. When the child was 4 and a half, Auntie May came back. Big and strong, off the boat and over the landing stage to the compound, she looked about her, at once spotting Edward with his orange hair, naked and sucking a mango, his feet and hands as pale with the mud of the compound as the other children's. She made no move towards him. The women were watching from the dark openings of the huts, but nodded and smiled in his direction, to his surprise, for his mouth fell open, and went on to climb the steps of the veranda. She was expected. There had been correspondence for some time, but Captain Feathers had not been at the landing stage. She had not seen him for 4 and a half years, but rumour had it that he was unchanged in his attitude to his son, that his shattered ankle was worse, and that he was drinking heavily. It was said he had become eccentrically, pedantically absorbed in his work and the management of his district. He was celibate. No girls were brought to him by their mothers as extra servants, though he was handsome still, his eyes bright with malaria. He turned away from the women's beauty to the beauty of the whisky in the glass. It did not seem to harm him. He had the Scottish immunity, He drank alone, for he had no friends.
Oh, Miss Neil. Auntie May.
Good evening. He looks tired, she thought. She had come to take the child down to the port to be taught English for 6 months before the journey home, where he would live with a Welsh family until he was 8. After that he would go to his father's old prep school and then his father's old public school. Auntie May knew of the Welsh family with whom he was to be fostered. They were used to Raj orphans. There would be home-cooked food, and it would be cheap. Alistair Feathers was a Scot. And there were two aunts about, his sisters, in Lancashire, which was not really far away from North Wales. And of course, said Auntie May at dinner, watching the lowering of the whisky in the glass at the other end of the lamplit table, you will have to take him to Wales, in 6 months' time, and you will by then have paid for him in advance. Alistair Feathers' eyes stared. Outside, the madhouse noises of the jungle. Inside, the servant padding about, taking plates, setting down others, offering fruit.
He seems well and happy, he said. I've never seen the need for him to go home. It's not the law.
You know perfectly well that it is the custom. Because of the risk of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.